Hi, my name is Angela Valente Romeo.
Welcome to Colliding Worlds,
an art documentary in a 30-minute format.
Come with us as we take you on another journey.
Hi, my name is Gordana Gelhausen, and welcome to the back of my studio and my shop called Goga.
We're in Santa Monica. This is Angela Valente Romeo. This is Colliding Worlds. We're going to meet Gordana, and you're going to tell me, where do you get your inspirations for these really wonderful clothes?
Oh my God, I know everybody usually asks me that, but it's so interesting as a designer, and you are yourself a designer, you know, you do jewelry. It's anything that you see inspires you. Movement, light, a person walking by, you see them wearing something and you go, oh, that's cool, but I would do it this way. It's somehow your brain is programmed to just see everything in a different light.
When you start, does the fabric dictate a lot of how the dress will go, or do you sort of take control?
It depends. Like sometimes I have in my mind what I want to do and then I go choose the particular fabric that I want to execute it with. But sometimes I see a fabric and I go like, wow, I love this print and what could I make with that? So it really goes both ways.
And you do a lot of mixing with prints.
Yeah.
Which I kind of like.
I like textures. I think I like the unexpected textures, you know, like to put them together and just kind of something that gives birth to itself.
And they do. And a lot of the pieces, at least the pieces I own, there's a hard edge, but they're extremely feminine.
I always think of the woman and the shades that we are made of. You know, like the strength, the courage, the, you know, femininity, the sexuality, you know, like, and I always try to embrace all of them in the clothing. And sometimes you will see the shape or the form of a dress is very strong. She's almost like a warrior. But then you have the flowingness of the fabric that makes it look so romantic.
There's something about them, and you do feel really comfortable wearing them. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of a nice feeling to wear something that beautiful.
Well, I feel like being a woman myself, you know, being 48 years old, it's like I am past struggling in my clothes. You know, I do want to feel beautiful but be comfortable. It's a really, really major thing for me.
How did you get into this? Were your parents in the clothing business?
Not at all. Oh my God. I remember growing up thinking I was probably adopted, or like I felt so misplaced. You have no idea. My parents are farmers, uneducated people, survival children after the Second World War. And I tend to say if I didn't run away from home, I'd be raising corn and potatoes. But I remember my mom hiding scissors from me because that was the tool that I destroyed everything with. I mean, shirts, and we didn't really have much. I grew up in a socialist country, you know. When you go shopping and you buy yogurt, you have one kind, you know. You have one kind bread, one kind milk, you know. And so I didn't have Walmart or a place to go to buy abundance of fabric. And when I say, give me a sheep, I make you a sweater, I literally mean it, you know. I can totally take the wool and make the yarn out of it, dye it, and knit it into sweater.
But that's what's kind of neat, though, when you know how to actually do that, because then you have a whole different respect for the material.
It makes you so resourceful. Like, I can make you something of nothing. I mean, it's like, just wherever I go, I will find something that I can turn into clothing.
No waste. It's like you save every little piece because you know you can do something with
exactly. it. Exactly. I mean, it's like you really, I mean, that's how I am with my food. That's how I'm with everything, you know, in my life. It's when you grow up not having things, you appreciate things that you do have. And like, I don't over-indulge. What's it called? Indulge?
Yeah.
I don't overindulge myself in things, you know. I just get what I need.
Looking back over the journey, mm-hmm. you know, it takes a lot of bravery to go out into the world, especially to design clothes.
In anything it takes bravery. I just had an interview actually from somebody in New York, and it was more about business, you know, situations and what makes a person decide to go into business. Because if you think about competition, name me a business, there is a competition out there. In anything.
Right.
And really the biggest challenge is to overcome yourself and your own fears. Because if you really honestly look into yourself with any idea, the first thing that comes to your mind is the negative. Every positive thought you have, you will turn it into negative. If you can eliminate the negative part and just go with your heart to the positive and just let it flow, then that's what takes you somewhere. America helped me realize who I am, because when I lived in Europe, first I was making clothes out of need, then I was making it out of love. Because when I was 12 years old, I was this invisible child, so skinny, nobody paid any attention to me. And I remember making out of some discarded suede jacket that somebody gave me, you know, like I made little skirt and I dyed this t-shirt. My brother came from the military, and you know, military is mandatory in Europe. And I went to some fair, and all at once, everybody noticed me. People started actually looking at me. And that became so contagious, you know, all at once I gained identity that I didn't have before. And I realized how looks are important and how me contributing to it, me making them, it's like making my own identity. So that was it. I mean, that one little outfit that I made changed me. And see, in Europe, people don't give you compliments. They look at you or they might say, where did you buy this, you know? But in America, you walk the streets and people are like, oh my God, you know, I love this or I love that. And I remember coming to United States, and the best store at that time was Banana Republic. And I was wearing my own clothes. People would stop me on the streets constantly asking me about it. So one day I decided to make a little collection, and I actually lived in Atlanta at that time. And I took it to one individually owned boutique, and the lady took everything from me. And literally 2 days after Atlanta Magazine called me, and they're like, who are you? And that was my first publication that I had in United States, in Atlanta. And then it just kind of like, every time I walked away from fashion, somehow the universe put me back into it. And I just gave in. I'm like, okay.
Now, Project Runway made you more visible to a larger audience.
Yeah.
But you were really entrenched in all of this long before
that. Oh, yeah. I mean, I remember actually having my own boutique. First of all, I started business with $3,000. When people say, you know, like, you need to have beaucoup of money or whatever, no. You need to have creativity and the desire and to work hard. And then, and actually it's better when you don't have money, because you get really creative with your means. I would go, I mean, I know I'm spilling my secrets here, but I remember going to TJ Maxx, buying men's white shirts, cutting the bottom part, adding sheer fabric to it, and then dyeing it in these like watercolor fabrics and texturizing them and selling them. So, I mean, I was like scrounging everywhere.
You're upcycling before it was trendy.
Because I had no money to buy anything, so. But yeah, like, and nobody wanted really to rent me a place. I didn't have money to some huge lease or something. So I found this gallery, you know, that had like different rooms, and I subleased from them. And I'm like, okay, let's do it month to month. If I fail to pay, you kick me out. And that's how it started.
Now here you are, you have children, you've developed a business model, you're very creative, you've been successful with it. Somebody looking out at you is going to go, well, you know, she had all these advantages, and you've proven that, no, you didn't need the advantages.
I didn't have any advantages.
The drive and the desire.
Yeah. People always will find reasons to say no to themselves. Oh, I'm too old, or I'm too busy, or I'm too this, too that. I mean, I was busy too. I was working for corporate America, you know, 40 hours a week or whatever. I would come home and still find time to, like, to sew stuff, before I got my first shop. I had inventory that I was collecting for a long time. I really think that we can always find excuses. It's the same like working out, you know. You will find excuses not to work out, but if you really want to do it, you will do it.
You always find the way.
Yeah.
It's your desire and your drive, and I think that's what people need to see and admire, and I'm glad you sat with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and I feel the same way about you. Thank you so much. You tackle so many different things, and it's so beautiful to see people doing different, just doing.
It's like just a
like Nike would say, just do it.
And they're right.
Hi, I'm Brett Philpott. AIDS Life Cycle is a thrill to participate in. So many of people have lost friends, loved ones, fathers, mothers, sons to AIDS, and they're all getting on these bikes and they're riding to help find the cure. But I do want to admit, it is a lot of work. And I can't do it though unless I also have the contributions towards AIDS Life Cycle. AIDS Life Cycle is an organization that is here to help with the pandemic of AIDS and those living with HIV. The beneficiaries of this are the San Francisco AIDS Foundation and the Los Angeles Gay and Lesbian Center. The money used from this event is there to help with AIDS prevention, AIDS education, and those living with HIV with their medicines and their food and their lodging and things that they can't do for themselves necessarily anymore, and our government agencies don't have the money to fund. I am riding my bicycle from San Francisco to Los Angeles next June 2nd through June 8th in AIDS Life Cycle Ride, and I need your support. And we must help those that can't afford to help themselves in this dreadful pandemic. Please, find it in your heart, send out some love, whether it's small or large. I have lots of incentives, I'm giving away paintings, and I appreciate everything that you and I can do for those other than ourselves. Thank you.
Hi, this is Angela Valente Romeo, and this is Colliding Worlds, and today I'm gonna bring you some of my favorite things. Fashion, art, jewelry, art, alternative materials, and art. Come along with us and we're going to take you on another journey.
My name is Annemieke Broenink and I'm from Amsterdam.
And I'm Maxine Weintraub. I'm from Chicago and my affiliation has been with the Museum of Contemporary Art in Chicago.
And this is an amazing story. You two have a journey that starts with these pieces. Talk to me about this jewelry. I loved it the first time I laid eyes on it. It captures everything I love. It's different. It's fashionable. It'll never go out of style. Alternative materials. How? Tell me.
Thank you so much. I'm a fashion designer. I had my education in the Netherlands and I'm based in the Netherlands, and I was intrigued by lace. But I worked in fashion industry for such a long time, and then I really wanted to start a business of my own, and I started to make lace out of fabrics because I was intrigued by lace. And then suddenly I took some classes and I saw someone working with rubber, and
these are amazing.
And I thought I can make lace out of it.
And you have?
I did well, but the first collection was so totally different, but it was lace, and I actually started to draw lace with rubber, and it was based on the curtains of my husband's childhood.
They're so intricate and so delicate, and at the same time there's a strength to them. When you first showed this to your husband, and he'd say, "You're nuts."
No, he thinks I'm wonderful.
There's a man who's not sleeping on the sofa tonight.
You bet.
But they're very interesting because, you know, these pieces here, like the pieces Maxine are wearing, they're bigger and they're bolder and they look more like spines than they do like lace, but they're all part of the same.
This has evolved. This is where she...
First I made the lace, and then I met Maxine, and Maxine, she brought fun into my life. So I started to make fun. And you know, you can turn those neck pieces into bracelets, and you can wear them as
belts.
Also great
belts.
And you know, you can really play with it, and it's fun. And that's what Maxine did to me. She made fun.
But here's this question now. Part of what we do here, it's like, this is art. And this is a skill that not many people would ever have thought of or come up with a combination. You're classically trained. You went through fashion, and you've been involved with the business. This is not something that they teach you in school.
Oh, no.
No, but you, what I teach you at school is to experiment and never be satisfied with what you are doing. And that's what I am. I'm never satisfied with my product, and I always want to make it better. And it's about taste, and they learn you to have taste and to throw things away. I throw 99% away. I make every day an experiment and I throw it away. And the one piece I really, what is good, I make it better, and I make it 100 times, and then I throw it away, and there's the one which is the best, and I will keep that.
It's a game of inches then. I mean, it's perfection that you're going for in a world, in a material that doesn't allow perfection.
The process is, as you said, experimental. So she'll take the rubber and she'll mix the colors, paint, all these different colors.
The colors are amazing. And that's what I love about it too. It's not just black and white. There's color, there's life to these things. They take on a world of their own. They transform a lot of things. I mean, this could be on a naked model and it's going to look just as great as somebody in a formal gown.
I visited Annemieke in Amsterdam, and we went shopping together for paint colors, because my store, the Museum of Contemporary Art store in Chicago, had urban tastes. It was different than what the colors in Holland. So I started pointing to colors. Try this, try this, try this. So we would buy paint, we'd go back to her studio, and she would mix the liquid rubber with the color, and it would come out entirely different than it looked in the bottle.
Of course.
So it's about experimentation, as she says, and sometimes they were happy accidents, that what we thought was going to be one color
accidents.
Turned out to be something else,
yes.
And it was perfect.
I got my inspiration from everywhere. I pick things from the street, I collect things, I pin it on my wall, and then I make things, and suddenly I realize, oh, wow, it's that picture, what was hanging on the walls.
So you find inspiration everywhere, from the crayon that falls on the street to the cloud in the sky.
Really? From everything.
What I love about these pieces is I think that jewelry is an adornment. It's personal adornment, and you wear your jewelry. Your jewelry does not wear you. These pieces are very wearable, and what I love about them, they're conversation starters. You cannot help but walk up to somebody and go, oh my God, where did you get this?
You got so much attention when you are wearing those.
It's funny, but you do. And it's like people want to know more.
Yeah.
And I want to know more. I love the work, but I want to know more about you. This is now taking you from the Netherlands to Palm Springs, California, to Paris, to Chicago. Where has little bits and pieces of rubber and your husband's lace curtains taken you?
Exactly.
Yeah, that's true.
It's a beautiful story and a beautiful journey, and she brings joy wherever she goes.
Did you think when you started you would travel the world with this?
No, but there was something inside. I thought I can make things no one else can make, and I really want to go for it.
And you have. Now, these are deceptively light, but they're sturdy.
Yeah.
Yes, they're on elastic, and it's elastic, it's rubber, it's natural. And
you put it in your
pocket and bring it with you on a trip. And
doesn't set off metal detectors. I love that part of it.
I love that part of it, too.
You can do all kinds of things. You can mix and match with them.
And it's safe to travel with because it has no street value. No one's going to grab it off your neck.
Yeah, right. You can wear this on the subways and still have your neck.
That's right.
I mean, I lived in New York, and you spent half your time in the subways, like, turning your jewelry around,
right.
Or, you know, not wearing your jewelry, losing it in the bottom of your bag. Or then you learn to take car service, so it's all over. But this you could wear to court in the Bronx and survive.
That's right.
What I like about it is there's life to it. There's a lot of joy in what you do. It's ultimately your
goal to create the joy or to create the peace?
I want to make things that they don't exist. I want to make new things. I want to create. That's what I like. And of course, I like to earn money. That's also
the dirty little
nice
secret. For heaven's sakes!
The beauty of these two is that they are affordable, and so there are people who are drawn to them who don't make much money, and there are people who are multi millionaires who are drawn to it. And it's just a look how beautiful that
but
is.
But it's just it's a very easy piece to wear, and it is attainable. And this is what's interesting. I always tell people, I think art to wear is a wonderful thing. I also think that if people look a little further, it's so much easier for just a little bit of money to have something that's unique as opposed to everything that's mass-produced. This is the piece of artwork that I can carry for a very long time. And I can see it black tie, on the beach, whatever. There's a versatility to it. But there's a craft and an art to it. And that's what's amazing to me, what you've been able to do.
Well, thank you so much. Thank you.
I think it's great. And I hope you keep creating these forever because I have multiple wardrobes, so.
The TSA guy, as I'm going through, says, oh, that's so cool. He's saying people are drawn to you because of it.
And the best part about it, and my other thing, art is universal. It doesn't matter what language you speak. Yeah. It doesn't matter. And this is a prime example of the irrelevancy of words. You don't need them. Thank you so much for being a part of my little
neck
of the world.
Thank you so much. Thank you. You were so kind.
This has been fun.
It's
a beautiful word.
Yeah.
I think we should all have a piece. But this has been Colliding Worlds, and I really hope when you walk away from this that you see arts everywhere.
These are the jewelry stylings of Angela Valente Romeo. Upcycled adornment with purpose. Meaningful, provocative art. Each piece individually crafted, combining past, present, and future to tell its own story. Visit us at www.theonlyonejewels.com.
Hi, this is Angela Valente Romeo, and this is Colliding Worlds, but it's a little different collide today. I'm going to talk to you about my work as an artist. I'm a jewelry designer, I'm a photographer, and the work behind me is my two-dimensional work. I don't know what else to call it, but two-dimensional. So come along with me and I'm going to take you on my little journey. I've always liked to do work that's a little bit different, whether it was with my jewelry, whether it was with my photography, whether it's even with my ceramics. I've always liked things just a little bit different. The work behind me now is my two-dimensional work, and it's done on what's called scratchboard, which is a taking away kind of a situation. I'm not adding to, I'm taking away, and it's a very unforgiving thing. A lot of this was inspired by thoughts and things that have always sort of intrigued me. Some of the pieces were styled after kimono patterns. And why the kimono patterns? Because they're intricate and they're beautiful. They were a form of self-expression that served a practical purpose. Especially this piece that has a little something to say. I want people to look back and reflect and understand what it is that they do and how they impact on everyone's life. Again, it goes back to my other philosophy of just because something's old doesn't mean it has to be thrown away, and the golden rule may be old, but it's something we should aspire to. I recently did a series of ceramics called Women Born, and they are made of porcelain torsos. Each one is clearly a female figure, but each one leads you to something else, whether it's men born of war, men born of peace, women oppressed by their own sense of belonging, whether it's through their beauty or through their intelligence or through something that sort of keeps them behind. It's part of
everything we do impacts on somebody else. It's been an interesting little journey. Sometimes it's not pretty and sometimes it's pretty. A lot of what I want to say has got a little political edge, and it's kind of things that sneak up on you. It's just the way it goes. But the work, I hope, inspires somebody else to think outside the box, to look at themselves. We've interviewed a lot of artists on the show, and the common denominator is they all create what's in their heart and what's a part of who they are. There's not a lot of people who are doing commercial art, so, you know, they're not creating advertisements. They're creating art that has something to say, and this is my work, and I do believe it has something to say. Only time will tell. It seems that only a dead artist is a famous artist. Who knows? But take a look at it, and you can see what I did with some of these things is to try to bring you into a, try to do something a little different. And again, this particular work is scratchboard, which is not a normal medium that people see. People see a lot of photography. A lot of it, my earlier work is based on my photography. Works like this were based off of the samurai, based off of the kimono fabrics, and behind it is custom paper that reflects the design. Again, pulls you in, makes you think, and makes you remember a culture that was able to incorporate the practical and the beautiful all at the same time. And the Japanese do a wonderful job with that. And again, sometimes you get a little political. The Buddha says, do no harm. And I think you have to know harm to not do harm. Again, that's just me being me. The porcelain work, again, is just a reflection of all of that. Everything you do is, as I said, impacts on people. And everything I do is I see as a growth, as a step, as something going forward. We're never going back. We can only go forward. And again, it's like I want you to think, I want you to be drawn into it, and hopefully realize everything you do, there's a reaction and an action and an action and a reaction, and it's just, that's what we do. This is my work. It's me. It's out there. And like any artist, you always wonder what people are going to think and say. Sometimes it doesn't matter, and other times it does. But this is me, this is my journey, this is my world, and welcome to it. Thank you.